This module will explore patient rights and advocacy for your patients within the auspices of legal requirements and ethical principles. Once completed with this module, you should be able to identify patient rights inherent in providing EMS care and describe how the paramedic serves as a patient advocate. This module addresses legalities related to patient rights and advocacy as applied to paramedics. In providing this information, nothing in this presentation should be construed as legal advice. Rather, the information provided is merely a broad overview of this legal subject as denoted within the National Paramedic Educational Standards. Please be aware that every state has different laws that impact EMS agencies and providers, and these laws may change over time by application of legislative action or court decisions. Federal, state, and local laws and other legal provisions not discussed within this presentation may also impact EMS agencies and providers. Additionally, information that was current or applicable at the time this presentation was produced may not be at the time you are watching this presentation, and new laws may have been added as well. Lastly, the legal topics and doctrines discussed within these presentations are not the totality of all laws that apply to EMS agencies and providers. There are numerous other laws and provisions that impact diverse aspects of providing EMS. If you or any other EMS provider has questions related to the laws that apply within the realm of providing EMS, additional guidance and assistance should be obtained from a licensed attorney within your area who has subject matter expertise in the specific area of law in question. While it should go without saying, healthcare providers have a duty to provide high-quality medical services to all patients they encounter. This means that a healthcare provider, regardless of his or her personal religion, values, or political beliefs, must treat all patients with dignity and respect while providing high-quality, non-judgmental care to everyone. Failure to do so in certain instances could be illegal if discriminatory care is provided based upon an individual's race, gender, national origin, military history, or other legal classification, which can vary by state given additional protections provided by state law. As a matter of fact, Section 1557 of the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act of 2010 prohibits any healthcare provider receiving funding from the federal government, which would include Medicare, to refuse to treat or otherwise discriminate against an individual based upon race, color, national origin, sex, age, or disability. This particular provision is enforced by the Federal Office for Civil Rights. Along somewhat similar lines, also keep in mind our previous discussion on consent. An individual patient may refuse care or treatment based upon his or her own religious or personal beliefs. An EMS provider typically cannot force care on a patient who has capacity to make healthcare decisions for him or herself, even if the patient does so at his or her extreme peril. On the flip side, however, an EMS provider cannot withhold necessary and proper care to a patient willing to receive it because the EMS provider has a religious or personal aversion to the treatment. Beyond anti-discrimination laws, the paramedic who fails to provide appropriate treatment to a patient, regardless of the reason, may find him or herself involved in a medical malpractice, negligence, or civil tort lawsuit. Remember as well that EMS providers have an ethical duty to their profession and their patients as well. The National Association of Emergency Medical Technicians adopted a code of ethics for EMS practitioners all the way back in 1978. There was a revision to the code in 2013. The very first line of the EMS Practitioner Code of Professional Ethics states that EMS providers will conserve life, alleviate suffering, promote health, do no harm, and encourage the quality and equal availability of emergency medical care. The next provision states that the EMS provider will provide services based on human need with compassion and respect for human dignity, unrestricted by consideration of nationality, race, creed, color, or status, to not judge the merits of the patient's request for service, nor allow the patient's socioeconomic status to influence the EMS provider's demeanor or the care he or she provides. There are 11 specific statements within this ethical code, and the very first two are very clear about equal access to emergency medical care and equal care, compassion, and respect to everyone regardless of their background and classification in society. Aside from an ethical responsibility, the World Health Organization considers the highest attainable standard of health as a fundamental right of every human being. This belief is so fundamental to the World Health Organization that the language just shared is part of the World Health Organization's constitution going back to 1946. Inherent in this basic human right is an obligation to ensure all people realize and enjoy this right to health without discrimination on the grounds of race, age, ethnicity, or any other status. Simply stated, every EMS provider owes all patients a duty to provide the highest quality healthcare experience he or she can, regardless of the patient's background, beliefs, ideology, or societal classifications. Another significant legal right enjoyed by patients is that of confidentiality. Healthcare is very personal, and for many people, sharing information of such a personal nature can be very embarrassing or exposing. Yet, despite this hesitancy to allow others to see, know, or interact with us in such an exposed condition, it is of critical importance that they do. If someone is experiencing a medical problem or emergency, it is imperative that the patient share all the information necessary for the healthcare providers to develop a working diagnosis from which to generate a possible treatment plan. If the patient is worried that confidential information shared with an EMS provider will be distributed to others, that could severely undermine the trust within that patient-paramedic relationship, and the patient becomes much more guarded and refuses to provide important information that could ultimately result in poor or inadequate care. Such confidential information typically includes the patient's medical history, including recent history that led to the current medical emergency, any assessment findings of the EMS crew, and treatments provided. While such information is typically shared verbally with the EMS crew, visual information or exposing an individual patient's body is also considered protected as well. As an example, exposing a patient's bare chest is typically necessary to apply a 12-lead. If the patient is concerned about the EMS provider sharing what he or she saw with others when exposing the patient for the purposes of conducting an assessment or performing a treatment, the patient may withhold consent for that activity, which could foreseeably undermine the process of therapeutic communication yet again. To protect patient confidentiality, many states as well as the federal government have generated laws clarifying what information is protected, what can be released either with or without patient permission, and what types of enforcement mechanisms and penalties exist to discourage impermissible disclosures. Such laws include the Federal Health Insurance Privacy and Accountability Act of 1996, HIPAA, and state laws, including Wisconsin's Confidentiality of Patient Healthcare Records Law, State Statute 146.82. Focusing on HIPAA for a moment, there are times when confidential patient information can be released by a healthcare provider, but those disclosures cannot occur without permission from the patient. Such disclosures include those made to a patient's parents, legal guardian, or someone else who has a legal right or privilege to such information. There are other types of disclosures that may be made without the patient's permission, as such disclosures are required for the patient benefit, for the safe and efficient operation of the healthcare system, or because other more pressing laws govern the release. Such disclosures without patient permission include sharing information with other parties who need to know, such as other healthcare providers involved in the patient's care. When legal mandates require it, such as the issuance of a subpoena, or when a state's open records law or sunshine law mandates the release of that information, or when the healthcare provider needs to share the information to function efficiently, such as sharing information with a third-party billing company, or when using information for CQI activities. If information is released in violation of one of these laws, not only is the patient's and public's faith in the system eroded, but there could be other negative repercussions for the healthcare agency and, possibly, the individual healthcare providers involved in the disclosure as well. HIPAA is enforced by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Office for Civil Rights. While HIPAA does not create a private right of action, meaning the individual patient who was wronged by the breach may not directly sue the healthcare provider or agency, the HHS-OCR may levy considerable penalties, especially if a disclosure is willful. This does not completely alleviate all concern for healthcare providers, however, as many states have their own confidentiality laws that may provide for this private right of action. Other civil wrongs may also be pursued at state law, such as invasion of privacy torts, including ridicule, unwanted notoriety or embarrassment, and defamation, libel, or slander. Patient confidentiality was discussed already in greater length in a previous module, so that is all we will explore regarding the patient right to confidentiality within this particular module. That does not minimize, however, the importance of recognizing, supporting, and ensuring the right of a patient to confidentiality in his or her own body, medical information, and interactions with healthcare providers. Additional patient rights that are important to understand within the realm of EMS are those attached with the Emergency Medical Treatment and Labor Act of 1986. Believe it or not, before the passing of this particular law, it was common practice in some areas for hospitals to refuse emergency services to patients based upon their ability to pay. The practice of patient dumping occurred often, in which hospitals transferred patients to other facilities without properly stabilizing them, or they would simply refuse to help them because they were unable to pay. As you can imagine, this had a huge disparate impact on those from lower socioeconomic backgrounds, which typically correlated higher with minority populations. Under EMTALA, a hospital must provide an appropriate medical screening examination of any patient who comes to its emergency department, requesting examination or treatment for a medical condition to determine whether an emergency medical condition exists. If it does, the hospital must stabilize the patient's medical condition before transferring or discharging the patient. If the patient is a pregnant woman in active labor, she must be admitted and treated until the delivery is completed, unless a transfer is necessary for the safety, health, and well-being of the mother or the baby. All of this must be done without any consideration as to whether or not the patient has the financial resources to pay for the services. So how does this law impact EMS? There are actually two factual scenarios that come into play here. The first is that of hospitals diverting EMS crews. While EMTALA does not apply directly to non-hospital-owned ambulances, in 2008 the U.S. Court of Appeals for the First Circuit held that a hospital can violate EMTALA by diverting a non-hospital-owned ambulance to other hospitals without being on formal diversionary status. Previously, if an ambulance crew contacts a hospital via phone or radio and is told the hospital is on diversion, the patient was deemed to have not come to the hospital for the purposes of EMTALA. In this 2008 case, however, the facts seem to indicate that the hospital's reluctance to receive the patient was related to the patient's ability to pay for services. Therefore, the radio communication between the ambulance crew and the hospital was deemed enough by the court to have considered the patient as having come to the hospital, thus establishing an EMTALA obligation on the part of the hospital to the patient. As an aside, even if an ambulance is diverted, it is recognized that if the ambulance still transports to the hospital, an EMTALA obligation exists, even if the hospital tried to divert the ambulance. The situation is not much different than if the patient arrived at the hospital's emergency department through a means other than an ambulance. The hospital must still evaluate and stabilize the patient. If the ambulance is actually owned by the hospital, the case is somewhat simpler. By virtue of being in an ambulance owned by a hospital, the patient is deemed to have come to the hospital. The ambulance is simply an extension of the hospital, and the hospital has an EMTALA burden to the patient in one of its ambulances. The second aspect of EMTALA that impacts EMS operations is when an emergency department fails to intake a patient for a considerable period of time after the arrival of that patient via ambulance. What often happens is the ambulance crew is left waiting for extended periods of time with the patient at the hospital until someone with the emergency department or triage actually assumes patient care from the ambulance crew. Referred to as patient parking or ambulance hijacking, this practice can have a considerable negative impact on the EMS agency, which must still respond to calls for service while it has an ambulance crew at a hospital with a patient waiting for the hospital staff to assume patient care. The Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services distributed a letter already back in 2006 that stated the practice of delaying the transfer of EMS patients to hospital care once the ambulance arrived at the hospital does not negate the hospital's duties under EMTALA. CMS stated in its letter that the practice of patient parking may result in an EMTALA violation, while also raising serious concerns for patient care and the provision of emergency services in the community. Once an EMS crew presents a patient to the hospital is obligated under EMTALA to provide a screening examination to determine if an emergency medical condition exists and, if so, provide stabilizing treatment to resolve the patient's emergency medical condition. This duty exists whenever a patient is presented to a dedicated hospital emergency department, whether the patient arrived via EMS or otherwise. The CMS letter went on to state that CMS recognizes the enormous strain and crowding many hospital emergency departments face every day. However, this practice is not a solution. Parking patients in hospitals and refusing to release EMS equipment or personnel jeopardizes patient health and impacts the ability of EMS personnel to provide emergency services to the rest of the community. With this in mind, it is important for EMS providers, paramedics in particular, to be advocates for not only themselves but their patients as well. Patients have the right under EMTALA to a screening examination at hospital emergency departments to determine whether or not the patient is experiencing a medical emergency. If so, that right extends further to the patient receiving necessary stabilizing treatment, regardless of his or her ability to pay for that treatment. Being inappropriately diverted when doing so would cause grave harm to the patient, or being held in waiting while at the ED for someone to assume patient care of the patient may be grounds for an EMTALA violation on the part of the hospital, and EMS crews should have some familiarity with these patient rights to be able to advocate effectively for their patients. Another patient advocacy topic that we need to explore in this module is that of shared decision-making. If you have not heard of the term shared decision-making within a healthcare context before, it is simply the understanding that healthcare providers must work with the patients they serve to develop a treatment plan together. Stated another way, the patient and healthcare provider go through a process of joint deliberation through mutual understanding to develop a treatment plan for the patient. Within the realm of EMS, this means that the paramedic must provide the patient with all the necessary information for that patient to make an informed health decision for him or herself. This would include telling the patient what working diagnosis the paramedic has generated, along with possible interventions. When describing the possible interventions, provide alternatives if available, tell the patient both the anticipated benefits as well as the possible risks, and also share what the possible outcomes are of not doing anything. Essentially, if you remember our earlier module on consent, the paramedic should provide all the information that is considered to be part of obtaining informed consent from the patient to proceed with an intervention. Now, while shared decision-making is not informed consent, as informed consent relates to the patient's ability to make decisions and to accept or refuse a particular treatment, intervention, or transport, the information shared with the patient to assist with shared decision-making is essentially the same as would be shared when obtaining informed consent. Additionally, under some truly emergent situations, shared decision-making may not be possible, and obtaining consent or relying on implied consent is all the paramedic can manage in the time available. When shared decision-making is being used, however, this comprehensive information is important for the patient to be able to decide what the best course of action may be given his or her own values, preferences, and opinions. Therapeutic communication is the foundation of shared decision-making, as the paramedic must have a productive dialogue with the patient to work together and generate a treatment plan that is ideally driven by the patient with input and help from the paramedic. Not only is this a good model for providing care, but it is also a great customer service practice that should hopefully improve the experience for the patient. Remember, this could be a very trying time for the patient. Garnering an understanding of what is going on and having at least some feeling of control over what is happening can go a long way in helping the patient's mindset and overall well-being. When transferring care to hospital staff, be sure to remember your ethical duty to be an advocate for the patient. Provide your handoff report and use the opportunity to develop a quick connection between the patient and the receiving facility staff. In doing so, you are providing the best treatment possible while helping to ensure a strong continuation of care for the patient. That completes the subject matter within this module. You should now be able to identify patient rights inherent in providing EMS care and describe how the paramedic serves as a patient advocate. This presentation was prepared by Waukesha County Technical College in Pewaukee, Wisconsin, and is distributed with an attribution, non-commercial, share-alike 4.0 International Creative Commons license. Copyright 2019, Waukesha County Technical College. For information on WCTC's numerous fire and EMS educational offerings, please visit us online at wctc.edu.